heroes of faith. And we've had an awesome pleasure, an awesome opportunity to look at Abel. And we talked about Abel and the blood sacrifice that he gave, the importance of that, and how God looks at our heart and motive. So we had a great opportunity to look at that. We had a great opportunity to look at Enoch, and we saw that Enoch had a relationship with God. And so we see that relationship is extremely important. So we saw that. And then we saw that we saw the life of Noah. And Noah had the work of God. Noah spent 100 years building a ark of salvation, if you will, for the sake of his family and humanity. And so, but in Abraham, we see it all come together. We see the righteousness come together. We see the walking with God come together. We see the working for God come together in the life of Abraham. And so we had an opportunity to look in our first part, looking at Abraham. This is our third week, looking at Abraham and focusing here. So just to recap for you, we saw in our first week that God told Abraham to go somewhere. He didn't know where he was going. And what an amazing thing. Told him to leave his family, his kindred, everything that was comfortable to him, everything that was familiar to him. He said, leave it all. And go to a place I'll tell you about later. He said, okay, wow. And then we saw last week that he had an awesome moment of God in his life. And that God not only changed his name from Abram to Abraham, he used that same H, that same connection, and he changed his wife's name from Sarai to Sarah. And so we saw this, the power of her belief in producing this wonderful son. And we saw that at the age of 75, and she was about 65, we said Abraham was 75, she's about 65, God told them that you're gonna have offspring. God was gonna make the things in your life. But God forgot to tell him to call out that I'm gonna do it for your wife. So he didn't even know how it was gonna happen. He didn't tell him at that moment, when he was 75, hey, I'm gonna produce a child through your wife. He says, your offspring will be great. And so they came up with a solution and a plan that they thought made pretty good sense. It made pretty good sense to me too. Said, I'm going to get my maid servant, my hand servant, I'm going to get my property, I'm going to allow you guys to get together, and we're going to produce a child. And God, later on, when he was about 90, she was about 90, and Abraham was about 100, he said, no, that ain't how I want you to do it. I'm going to do it for Sarah's life. And he saw that they began to believe in this wonderful child whose name is Isaac comes along. And so now we're in the last part of this story, and you won't believe what God is going to do now. I want you to understand one thing about faith. Faith is the ability, the capacity, the power, the desire to believe the unbelievable because of Christ. To believe that the unbelievable is possible. That's what faith is. Can you believe the unbelievable? I didn't put a period there. It's possible. What is that God desires to do in your life that seems so unbelievable? It seems so impossible, but God desires to do it in your life. And so we're gathered here today to find out how do we unlock the flow of God's promises, the flow of God's blessings in our lives. And I think in the life of Abraham, when we look at this story today, that's a few things we're going to see that's going to be absolutely explosive. So Hebrews chapter 11, I'm going to look at 17 through 19, and then I'm going to go back to the record in Genesis. Amen. This is what it says in my Bible. It probably says something similar. By faith Abraham, when he was tested, offered up Isaac, and he who had received the promises was in the act of offering up his only son, of whom it was said, through Isaac shall your offspring be named. He considered that God was able even to raise him from the dead, from which figuratively speaking, he did receive him back. Now let's go to Genesis, and we'll spend most of our time there. Genesis chapter 22, and I'll try not to walk in too many other places. But I want to go back to the original record. Let's look at Genesis 22, and let's hang around here for a little while. We're going to look at Genesis 22. We're going to take our time, but not too much. We're going to journey on down a little bit. Amen? A couple of things I want you to see. Genesis, the first book of the Bible, chapter 22. We're going to look at that first verse. Let me just teach you a little bit. Amen. And this is what it says. After these things, what things? What happened? What are you talking about, Lord? After these things, well, what happened? See, something happened. So most of the people we talk about that Abraham was a man of society. We put Abraham in this pedestal of being holy from the womb, if you will. Abraham was the son of an idolater. His father worshipped other gods and not God. And we saw that Abraham and Sarah, both of them, were individuals who were well acquainted with life. And God called them from that acquaintedness of life, and he called them to be something different. So after what things? After Abraham had failed. After Abraham and his wife decided that the promise was going to come through Hagar and the promise was going to come through Ishmael. After what things? After Abraham had lied and he told someone that, hey, that's not my wife. That's my sister. And the king said, well, since she's not your wife, I don't have to worry about sinning, but I'm going to take her to myself. And then God showed him, don't do that. You're going to have to do something to do it. But that's his wife. One of the hardest things to do is to go forward after you have failed. Has anybody ever failed before? Has anybody ever failed publicly before? I'm talking about when your failure is on public display. I mean, you have a really, really good relationship, but one day you and your spouse are just kind of went off on each other and everybody saw it. After public failure, maybe you've been married for a while and your spouse violated the marriage in some kind of way, and everybody knows it, and you're going to accept the spouse back, and you want to go forward, but everybody knows your business. After these things, after humanity, after failure, after yesterday, that is it today, and God has something to say. After these things, God tested Abraham and said to him, Abraham, and he said, here am I. First thing I want you to know about faith is that faith. It continues and it ends with God. You can't believe God. Now you may ask me up. You, in your humanity, cannot believe the unbelievable. It takes the seed of faith inside of you. It takes the measure of faith which God breathes the capacity on all of us if we will only choose to embrace that small measure of faith. But faith begins, it continues, and it ends with God. God called Abraham. Abraham did not call God. And the other thing I want you to know is that God called him Abraham and not Abram. Now, his birth name was Abram. His rearing name was Abram. His career name was Abram. His history was primarily known as Abram. But God didn't call him through his history. God didn't call him by birthright. God didn't call him based on what he had done in the earth. See, that's the thing about works and grace. If you believe it's what you do that makes you right with God, then God would call Abram. But that's who he was. That was his record. That was his behavior. He was Abram. But see, Abram was so ugly in the way he behaved, in the way that he carried on, God had to change his name. God had to change his identity. And so God calls him Abraham. So here you are. Now I have people say, well, Pastor, how do I understand my purpose in the earth? If the Holy Spirit is with us right now today, why not?
while I'm talking, God will say a special word to you. See, we're talking about purpose, we're talking about destiny, we're talking about assignment, we're talking about your name, we're talking about who you are. And right now, God is starting to tell it to you. Write it down. Put it on your phone. Tattoo it in your brain. He'll tell you. There's many businesses right now that have some of the most powerful business people in Houston, Texas, right now in this room. Did not how much money you have, did not how many contracts you have, doesn't matter how many accounts you have. Who are you in God? Some of you that are gathered are the most powerful entrepreneurs in this city. You just don't know it yet. Most powerful entrepreneurs in the city. Now the word God said, God calls those things that be not as though they are. And so if that is your name, if that is part of your assignment, if you're this great entrepreneur, anybody ever heard of Steve Jobs? Well, he was a failure. He got fired and had to kick him out of his own company. He was unemployed. He didn't have work. He didn't know what to do. Nobody answered his telephone call. Nobody wanted to go to lunch with him. And then God breathed on him and allowed him to do something great. So then in mid-90s, he gets his company back. He takes Apple in a new direction. And before he dies, it's the second most wealthiest brand in the world. Who are you? Unemployed Steve Jobs? Who are you? Steve Jobs got kicked out of his own company? Who are you? Only God can tell you who you are. I can't. We can't sit down for 30 minutes or an hour or have a cup of coffee. I can't tell you who you are. Only God can tell you who you are. Who are you? I believe this is the greatest church in Houston, Texas. I believe that. Now,
somebody. That's what makes you beautiful. I know my name in the spirit. I
satisfying. So he calls him what? He calls him.